In this class, we will discuss about the proposed mega terminal at Chennai, some of the environmental issues. This mega terminal is built, this is the existing port of Chennai, and we will be building two breakwaters. Proposed breakwaters are shown here. This is the fishing harbor. So, you can see that this terminal what we are going to build is much bigger than what is existing here. In India, the second biggest container terminal is Chennai. So, what we are having in Chennai is two container terminals, container terminal 1 here, container terminal 2 here. What we are proposing is the mega terminal here. This will be for a length of about 2 kilometers. Existing is 1 kilometer here and about 900 meters here. So, it will be such a big terminal here. To construct this terminal, what we need is one breakwater on this side and another breakwater on this side, the small arm here. And whatever material that is going to be dredged in these areas will be used for reclamation, so that we can use this area for transshipment facilities. This two breakwaters along with dredging what is being carried out and reclamation forms part of the mega terminal. The reclamation zone is shown here. The breakwater, we have two breakwaters. One is the northern breakwater. This breakwater length is about 1500 meters. Then we have the eastern breakwater. This length is about 2500 meters. We normally provide the top width of the breakwater is about 8 meter to take care of the 2-lane traffic, and the top level is kept as plus 5 meter. We have studied various location of turning circle. In the previous slide, the turning circle was at some other location, but this is the final chosen breakwater entrance channel and turning circle location. The existing turning circle is somewhere inside. One of the studies that we have to consider is sediment transport. The sediment transport, last class I said that 90% of the lateral drift movement is within twice the surf zone width from the shoreline. Surf zone is the zone where the waves break. Whatever is the width, you calculate the twice the width, and there we will have the 90% lateral movement. And we are planning to build the breakwaters well beyond the surf zone where the lateral transport is not significant. So, there cannot be any effect of the construction of the new breakwaters on the lateral movement. So, it will not have any impact on the adjacent shoreline. Hence, lateral drift would not significantly influence the adjacent shoreline. This is one of the main benefit of this particular development. So, as you see here, this is the zone of lateral zone, and we are building it beyond that. Here we have this where we are seeing the wave breaking, this white patch. That is the place where normally the waves will break. Twice the width if we take, it will be somewhere here, and we will be starting the breakwater here at this location, maybe about 10 meter contour, and here it is 5 meter contour. So, we will not have any effect on the shoreline. One of the major advantage of this container terminal is, as I told before, it is a transshipment terminal. At present, we are handling about 4500 TEU vessel, is what we are handling, and about we are providing a draft of around minus 15 meter, that is what we are providing to handle this vessel. This transshipment terminal, once it is commissioned, this will be handling about 18,000 TEU vessel, and we will have a depth of about 21 meters. So this is the existing terminal 1 and 2. And the proposed mega terminal is given here. The advantage is it is a transshipment terminal, whereas here the cargo comes and container comes, either you are loading or unloading, and this is going either by road or rail. What at present it is planned is about 2 million TEU approximately. This what is being handled here, and the length is around 1900 meters. But here for the transshipment terminal, you will have a bigger mainline vessel. From this it will go to a feeder vessel for unloading. For loading, from feeder vessel it will come to mainline vessel. This is the advantage. It is, this traffic is not for Chennai hinterland, this traffic can be for the entire east coast and other countries. So you will get a very big vessel, maybe 18,000 TEU vessel. And the feeder vessel can be 1000 TEU to 4500 TEU. This is the advantage of the transshipment terminal, and we do not have any transshipment terminal in India. Our cargo for India goes to Singapore or Colombo, where bigger vessel comes, and then from there it gets transferred. So we want to attract that. For that we need a very deep draft vessel. And the length of the berth is around 2000 meters. Typically we can keep 4 vessels of smaller size or 2 vessels of bigger size, 2 or 3 vessels. Typically per annum in 1 meter you can handle about 1500 to 2500 TEU per meter. This is what we can handle. In India, JNPT, they are handling around 2000 TEU per meter length of the quay. So here the length is around 2500 meters. If we take 1500 TEU per meter, we will be handling about 3 million TEUs. This is what we want to handle. So if you get a 1 million TEU cargo for transshipment terminal, you will be loading into feeder vessel 1 million TEU. That means you will unload from here 1 million TEU and then load it into the feeder vessel 1 million TEU. So you will get the throughput as 2 million TEU. Because the mainline vessel will come and it will unload the cargo into the terminal, backup space what we are creating. Then the feeder vessels will come in different times, and from this the feeder vessel also can come with some cargo, then it can unload the cargo. Then from the transshipment terminal it will take the cargo and take it out. That means when you create adequate storage and deep draft, the mainline vessel will come and unload the cargo and go, and the feeder vessel and come and take it back. The other way, the feeder vessel will come and unload the cargo, and you can load from the terminal to the mainline vessel. So the both the things are possible, and only 1 million TEU into 2, this is the catch here. and another 1 million TU is planned for Chennai hinterland, that is what is being planned. So there is an advantage in a transshipment terminal, because using the same infrastructure you will be able to maximize the throughput, because same container box, you take it from one bigger vessel, keep it on the berth and then put it back on a smaller feeder vessel. So this way this is very advantageous. And this is the, whenever we give the projection of traffic survey, we give optimistic, realistic and pessimistic. These are the three scenarios we can see. The pessimistic is 1500, realistic may be 2000, optimistic can be 2500. That means it can vary from 3 million TEU to 5 million TEU. That is what, if there is a traffic potential, then you will be able to handle this much amount of cargo. Another advantage of transshipment terminal is you do not need so much of road and rail linkages. So if there is a road and rail linkage required, then there is traffic problem, then pollution due to so many containers being transported, that problem also is not there. In addition to that, we are planning some more facilities here, some liquid terminal and bulk terminal, that is in the proposal stage only. So this particular slide, we are giving what are the environmental concerns that are to be addressed. Suppose even after considering that this sediment transport may influence some portion of the coastline, we have built a lot of groynes here all along the coast. The present coastal protection scheme, there are 10 groynes already built here and 3 are under progress. This will protect the shoreline. And the proposal of CPT, this is on the southern side, this is on the northern side, this is the port, this is on the northern side, this is the port and this is on the southern side. There they also, Chennai Port Trust is planning some groyne field, so that during northeast monsoon there will be erosion here, that can be avoided. So during southwest monsoon, when the waves are coming from this side, the erosion will be here. During northeast monsoon, when the waves are coming from here, the erosion will be here. So the southwest monsoon waves, when they are traveling like this, if there is a erosion here, these groynes will help. During northeast monsoon, when the waves are coming here, these groynes which are planted here south of this will prevent the erosion. Then we have this dredged material. Whenever you remove the soil by dredging, what are you going to use it for? Now we have planned that we will be using it for reclamation during capital dredging. This has an advantage. Suppose 200 rupees per cubic meter is the cost of dredging. If you want to reclaim the land, getting the sand from other place, it is another 200 rupees. So totally 400 rupees are required for dredging separately and the reclamation separately. Suppose you use the same material for reclamation, the 200 rupees dredging cost, the same cost you can reclaim also. Sometimes the cost will be less also, because if you want to dredge and dispose it off into the sea, the cost of transportation of the barges which are transporting is to be added. So if you want, if you can dredge and reclaim very close by, the cost of dredging also will come down. All the soil will not be useful for reclamation, because if it is a clay soil, it will not be useful. So we dump the excess spoil that is into the deep sea. And we have carried out in a hydrodynamic modeling where we can dump the soil. The requirement is, wherever you are dumping, from there it should not come back to where you have dredged. So because of the coastal movement and sediment movement onshore, offshore, that is one other thing we have to see, and it should not create any environmental problem also. In addition, the beach nourishment is also proposed on the northern side of fishing harbour, where there is some in spite of groynes, certain problems are associated with erosion. So we will do beach nourishment. So the dredged material, it will be disposed in three categories. One is for reclamation inside the mega terminal, other one is dumping the soil which cannot be used for reclamation in the deep sea, then artificial nourishment on the northern side as a stockpile. So the environmental aspects connected with any development can be summarized like this. One is the traffic, you have to build roads, rails, another thing. The second one is disposal of dredged material. And during construction of a breakwater, which is very, we will be using either artificial armor or stone, so there will be lot of transportation required for breakwater, that is rubble stone transportation. This also has to be studied. Normally the breakwater construction will take about 2 to 3 years because it is a very long breakwater in deeper water also. Then construction of berth will also create some pollution. Then this water, what you are using for construction or other purpose, you should not take it from the ground. So groundwater tapping is to be avoided. Then we need to have this sewage disposal, some water disposal, and other associated issues also we have to see. These are the various studies which you have to carry out to see that this particular structure, what you are building, will not create any problem. So what is planned for this breakwater construction is, we want to, the quarry will be identified. This is on the north of Hennur, around 60 kilometers. Then we have to take the required amount of stone. This is of the order of about 20 to 30 million tons, based on the type of breakwater what you are going to plan. I will explain about that later. And the stones will be transported through roads up to Hennur. This is the Hennur port. So the quarry will be somewhere here, you will transport by road. Here it is not a congested area, you can transport it through road. And from here we will be transporting by barges to the Chennai port, because if you want to transport the stone all the way to Chennai port by road, this is a heavily congested area. So there will be a various issues related to bottleneck of traffic and other things. So will be transporting it by barges. Another advantage is barge dumping is required for construction of breakwater, because it is easier to dump from the barge rather than from the road. And we can have barges, when you talk about the barges, so the barge, one set of barges can start construction of this, another set of barges can start construction of this. So you can do two breakwaters parallelly for the construction. Once you fill up this area and reclaim this and develop the port, from here if you want to transport it either by road or rail, there are certain proposals which are already there. There is already a direct connectivity to the port which is being planned, elevated corridor, so that will solve the problem. Once this is commissioned, parallelly that road also will be commissioned. This shows a typical cross section of the breakwater. This has a filter, core, primary armor, secondary armor, and this armor layers. These armor layers can be either tetrapod, this is what is being used in existing Chennai Port Trust breakwater, or a new type of design that is using acropod, which is successfully used in Hennur port. Both of the things will be considered. The economics of casting and placing of these units would decide the armor unit. But this breakwater construction will be for the private developer. This will not be done by Chennai port. So they will decide which type of breakwater they have to use. As I told, the eastern breakwater starts from 5 meter. So from 5 meter to 10 meter, we will use a rubble mount armor. That is, this armor will be rubble mount. And beyond 10 meter water depth, we will use either a tetrapod or a acropod for the breakwater. So this shows the rubble mount section. So here the armor units, what we are placing, will be about 2.2 meter thick with 2 to 3 ton stone. We provide 8 meter width for the breakwater, and it starts at about minus 3 meter contour. The top level will be kept as plus 5 meter. Any breakwater cross section will have a filter, a core, an armor, and a toe mount. This is the toe mount which will be placed. In 15 meter water depth, we will be going for a armor unit using acropods. When you use a very big size armors, between core and armor, we will have a core cover and a secondary armor unit that will be placed. But other things also will remain, that is, the filter, core, toe mount, armor will be there. In addition, we will have two more layers. Another important study to be carried out is the ship maneuvering study. That is, when you are bringing a bigger size vessel, we have to define the ship. That is, if it is 18,000 TEU vessel, what is the length, beam, and draft of the vessel? Then you have to define the environment, channels, depth restriction, turning circle, etc. You have to give the environmental load, and we should find out the output. What is this, the circular maneuver and manual voyage from approach channel into the main harbor? These are the studies which you have to carry out. For example, if for this particular structure which we are planning to do, somewhere here the tip of the breakwater is there. At this level, the water depth is around minus 20 meter. Somewhere here it is minus 10 meter. We have to dredge the channel for a width of about 21 meters inside. Then we have to make a harbor basin, a training circle also. So whenever the vessel comes here, they stop the engine here. It doesn't move. Normally, vessels move between 15 knots to 20 knots. 1 knot is 1.8 kilometer per hour. Generally, 15 to 25 knots it will be going outside. But when it comes to the port, it will slowly reduce the speed and it will come about 2 to 3 knots. Then they stop the engine. Then tugboats will go from here, then bring the vessel inside. So when you stop the engine, the vessel doesn't stop immediately because it is coming with a inertia, it does not have a brake. So the bigger size vessel, 18,000 TEU vessel, means the weight may be around 180,000 tons. So when it is coming with the speed, it will not stop on its own. You have to, there is no brake. You stop the engine, then it travels. The distance it travels before it comes to a complete halt is 7 times the length of the vessel. Suppose 300 meter is the length of the vessel, it needs 2.1 kilometer for bringing the vessel to a stop. So this distance is approximately 2.1 kilometer. Eastern breakwater length is 2500 meters. So the vessel will come. This is the manual voyage or using tug assistance. The vessel will come and stop. Then they will turn the vessel, and along this berth, they will berth the vessel. After unloading or loading, the vessel will start the engine and go out like this. So this study has to be carried out. We need very big harbor basin for carrying out this maneuver and all. So this study has also been carried out. So this shows again the layout of the mega terminal. What are the aspects relating to environmental clearance? There is CRZ 1, 2, 3 and 4 it is classified. I will explain about the CRZ zones at a separately. This does not come under CRZ 1, that we have to write that. They does not affect the livelihood of fisherman community because we are not disturbing the fisherman. The fishing harbor will have a protection from this breakwaters, the wave attack will be less. The container handling, because it is a pollutant free cargo, so there will not be any pollutants. At present, what is happening is, we are handling coal, iron ore and other cargoes in Chennai port. So this creates lot of dust and other problems. Slowly we will be shifting all this dusty cargo to Ennore port, and Chennai port will handle only the container cargo. And this long term plan for Chennai port is to make it as a clean cargo terminal. So we have clean cargo ports and dirty cargo ports. If you use iron ore, coal and all, it becomes very dirty, whereas a container is a clean cargo port. And I have listed out various schemes to be done for environmental clearance. And another important thing during construction phase is we have to use ready mix concrete. That means you don't make the concrete in the harbor basin, you get the supply from outside. No groundwater will be drawn from the CRZ area, and the site office also will be located outside the CRZ area. Then construction debris that will be disposed at the permitted area outside the harbor, and they will be using only the existing roads and railway line during construction period. And as we have told earlier, the capital dredging will be used for reclamation, and surplus soil will be used for beach nourishment. This is during the construction phase. During the operation phase, there will be only pollution free cargo, so there won't be any additional pollution. There is no inhabitants within 3 kilometers of the proposed site, and this will create a lot of employment opportunities during construction as well as under operation. This is direct benefit to the local community. This project will be handled in public-private partnership mode. This is called as a PPP mode of execution. The cost of the project is about 3,500 crores, and the breakwater and berths will be done by the private operator, and the dredging is to be done by Chennai port. So dredging is about 600 or 700 crores. The balance will be invested by the private operator. Now comes the viability of the project. Generally, in India, this viability of the project, there is a ballpark figure. Suppose you want to develop a port for handling 1 million ton. If the capital investment is between 60 to 100 crores, then it is viable. Depending on the type of cargo and the location and the hinterland development and competition, this will be there. But generally the upper limit, 100 crores, if it is there, it is okay. When you talk about 3 million TEU, that is equal to approximately about 40 million tons can take, and the cost is about 3,500 crores. So approximately the cost come to about rupees 90 crores per million ton. So this shows the viability of the project. So when you spend about 90 crores per million ton, when you handle it, then the project will become viable based on the charges what you are doing and all. This is the ballpark figure which can be used to see whether this project is viable or otherwise. So the next lecture I will be discussing about this development of DPR for many projects. There also we will be discussing about all these things. So this lecture will be on detailed project report. We will be discussing about 3 projects. The first project is a deep water deep draft port near Tirukkuvalai, Nagapattinam district, Tamil Nadu. The second project is coal unloading facilities for Dhopavai thermal power station. The third project is oil, container, coal and ore terminals at Paradip port. These 2 projects are considered as a greenfield project. Greenfield means there is nothing existing, you have to start afresh and start doing this. The third project is only a terminals which you are developing in the existing port. You are constructing separate terminals for these 4 different types of cargoes. This coal unloading facilities for Dhopavai thermal power station, this can be considered as a captive port. So when you talk about the port, we can talk about different classifications. One of the classification what we will be discussing is whether it is a captive port or multi-user port. Chennai port is a multi-user port where different people, we have car terminal, we have container cargo, we have liquid cargo for different users, that is called as a multi-user port. Captive port means if you are developing a power plant, you will be getting the cargo only for the power plant, then it is called as a captive power plant, captive port. So this Dhopavay thermal power station, what we are developing a coal unloading facility, is a captive port. This we are planning as a multi-user port. First see the Thirukkale port. This is the India map. Our Thirukkale is somewhere here. The location is shown here. So adjacent we have this Nagapattinam, Karaikal, Trankuppar. And here we have Vedaranyam, and this is a wetland. Somewhere here we have the Velangani. So this Thirukkale is when you develop a port from any historical site, this should be 10 kilometer away. Actually this is about 12 kilometer, and natural heritage and other areas also it should be away. So you cannot build any port facility here because it's a wetland. So this is far away from this wetland area, that is how this location is decided. One of the reason this port is being developed here is though it is a multi-user port, there is a proposal to build a power plant here. For this power plant, this will act like a captive port, but as a captive port this project is not viable, so they want to convert as a multi-user port so that they will use for their captive as well as for other cargoes. For that to do, we have to do a traffic study. This traffic study will tell you whether the project will be viable or otherwise. There are 5 segments of the traffic study. One is the base volume, that is a minimum guaranteed traffic, that will be for the captive power plant of the Tridam port. The hinterland, this can provide bulk cargo traffic to the port, this is for the multi-user port. And if you make it as a deep draft port, then it can attract port based industries. You have to provide modern facilities for that. In order to achieve this, we need a good road connectivity to hinterland, and you also need rail connectivity. These are the 5 significant components that are required to make the project successful. What are the cargo for this port? They can be classified into coal, granite, cement, fertilizer, sugar, molasses, edible oil, POL, LPG and containers. Here likely significance in traffic to Tridam is very high, that means it is definite that you will get this, and some of them are in medium category, some of them in low category. Container is in the medium category, so we are targeting this medium category containers and high category coal as a major source of cargo for this port. And this shows the hinterland, Nagapattinam, Kadalur and Salem district and central Tamil Nadu for fertilizer. And for containers, it is from Karur, Salem, Coimbatore, Madurai, Erode and Pondicherry. These are all industrially developed areas. At present this cargo goes either to Chennai or to Tuticorin. So once we develop a good facility, then this can attract this cargo. But whenever you develop any port, that is this is a Thirukkale port what we are developing, you have to see the competition adjacent. Already there is a port called Karaikal port, and Tamil Nadu we have already developed Chennai port and Tuticorin port and major ports, and Ennur port and Kattupalli port also are already developed. Then we have a Krishnapatnam port here. There is a small mistake here. Ennur port is this and Kattupalli port is this. This is Kattupalli port and this is Ennur port. In Cochin port, a container hub has been developed, that is Ollarpadam port. This is in the planning stage, that is the Vizhinjam port is in the planning stage. we will compare the three ports which will become competitive to Tridam port. One is Chennai, another is Tuticorin, the third one is Vallarpadam. The operators are DP World, PSA Sikkal, and this also DP World. The length is 885 meters. Subsequently, they added some more length that is being operated by PSA Sikkal. 370 meter is Tuticorin and 450 meter is Vallarpadam. Number of berths are 4, 1 and 1, 1 and 2. What is the maximum berth length? That is also given here. Draft is 13.4 meter in Chennai, Tuticorin is 10.7 and Vallarpadam is 14.5. So, if you go more than Chennai and very close to Vallarpadam, then you can attract cargo. The number of cranes, this is the most modern facilities we are talking about. So, number of cranes also decide how quickly you are able to load and unload. And then other occupancy factors and what is the time taken for dwell time for containers, average pre berthing time, how much time it has to wait, these are the factors that governs. To give a rough idea how much container is being handled, Chennai is 2 million tons, Cochin is 1.2 million tons, Tuticorin is 0.45 million tons. These are all the capacities. They may not be handling this much, they may be handling. I think Chennai port and Tuticorin port are very close. Vallarpadam has to achieve this target, they have not reached this 1.2 million. So, having seen the traffic potential, we have to make a layout. So, this shows the layout of the full terminal. We have an entrance channel, eastern entrance, there is a turning circle, some reclamation area is here, some reclamation area is here. This side we are developing the container terminal, this side coal terminal will be developed. Coal will be unloaded, three vessels will be there, and from here they will be transporting through a conveyor to the power plant directly. Containers will be loaded here, from here it will be going to other places. There are two rivers which are draining in, so we construct some draining walls on both the rivers so that the mouth will not get clogged because of the construction of the breakwater. And this whole facility cannot be developed immediately. Initially they will not develop all the facilities together. This will be done in a phased manner that you can see here. They want to develop phase 1 with two berths here and two berths here, not all the berths put together. So, if you see here there are three berths and three berths, whereas here they want to do two berths and two berths only. And they will restrict the dredging area. Dredging is a very major issue here. So, the 5 meter contour is somewhere here, but this bed slope is very flat. So, to reach this 5 meter contour, it will take more than 2000 meters. So, bed slope is 1:400. So, it is a very flat slope, that is one of the disadvantage for this, that is why the cost is higher. But the advantage is the environment is very calm. There is not, see, from this 5 kilometer bed, 5 meter depth to 14 meter depth, it has to travel for another 10 kilometers. It is a very large distance to reach port. So, you need a entrance channel which is more than 10 kilometer long outside the harbor basin, that is also a disadvantage. But this maintenance dredging will be less because there is not much of lateral movement. So, we are dividing the port into two phases. First phase we will be handling 8 million tons of imported coal and 0.6 million TEU of container. And the phase 2 we will handle 12 million tons per annum of imported coal and 1.5 million TEU of container traffic. But after this project has been prepared, there is a recession. This has been prepared since 2009 onwards. There is a recession, now this much of cargo throughput is not there. So, we have to revise the estimate. So, in phase 1 is reduced down to one berth only, coal berth, and still they are looking how to make this port economical and viable. இப்போ பாலமுருகன் அது என்னமா ஆயிடுச்சு பாரு, என்ன ஆச்சு ஹேங் ஆகுது. ஓகே, so these are the two phases that we have to do. That is the phase 1, we will be dredging up to 13.25 meter. The navigation, there are various components for this port. One is the navigation channel, the second one is the turning circle. Next we need the harbor entrance width, what is the dimension of the quay, what is the length of north and south breakwater, what is the dredging quantity, navigation channel, harbor basin and total. So we have to do it in two phases. Navigation channel initially will be done up to water depth of minus 13.25. So we will have 9467 meter of navigation channel, width is 180 meters. Afterwards we will increase the width to 250 meters and we go up to 16 meter contour and then make the all the length of about 14 kilometers to keep this navigation channel. Turning circle will be 480 meters and depth will be about 12.65 and in phase 2 500 meters and 15.5 meters. The entrance width for the harbor will be the same in both the cases. So the water depth is more in the navigation channel because due to wave cleavage the underkill clearance is more, required is more. That is why in the navigation channel the water depth is more and in the turning circle the water depth is less. So here we will have two bars, 536 meter is the length and 30 meter is the width, and container terminal 570 into 30 meter. In phase 2 we will build 930 by 30 and 1020 by 30. The breakwater lengths will remain the same, all the breakwater will be completed the first phase itself, second phase there won't be any additional construction. So you have to subtract here, when you take 1020 by 30, what we are meaning is 570 is already built, the balance 550 will be built in the second phase. This is the final what is going to be achieved. The navigation channel is 14 million cubic meter, here it will be 38.3 million cubic meter, harbor basin is 6.1, this is 9.3, this is 20.1 and this is 47.6. So Gopalpur port we discussed, the dredging requirement is only about 8 million cubic meter, whereas here it is 47 million cubic meter, it is 5 times more because there the contour is very steep. That is how this project is not picking up, whereas Gopalpur already they have started construction. Dredging cost is very high for this project. Then we have to talk about the design vessel. The design vessel is 80,000 EWT vessel and displacement is 1,05,000. Length is 259 meters, beam is 39.2 meters and the draft is 12.6 meter. That means we want to bring in 80,000 EWT vessels. So whenever we construct a structure, we do an analysis. The structure what we are building on the container berth will have a diaphragm wall on the back side so that you can reclaim the soil and load the container. This will be done with some expansion gaps. The total length is divided into 4 blocks. This shows one of the blocks. What you are seeing here is the fender panels where we will be putting the fenders. There will be 4 fenders which will be put in each block. So you will have the piles 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 rows of piles and a diaphragm wall on the back with cross beams and longitudinal beams. And this has to be decided for about a container crane which is about 30 meters span. And this container crane will have 4 legs, P, Q, R and S. Each leg will have about 8 wheels, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 wheels. The center to center distance between the extreme wheels are 10.5 meters. Center to center distance between one leg and another leg is 15 meters. The spacing between the wheels are 1.5 meters. The spacing between the rails is 30 meters. And the seaside crane rail, this is the seaside and this is the land side. The wheel load, each wheel load is 57.7 tons, whereas the land side the wheel load will be 53.10 tons because when it is picking the cargo the load will be more on the seaside. Then this is another mobile harbor crane. This also will have 4 pads like 4 legs of that, but each pad is a rectangular pad 5.5 by 1.8 meter. The center to center distance between the pads are 12 meter. This can move anywhere. The loading is about 20.9 tons per meter square in static condition, and dynamic condition it is 24.5 tons per meter square. The pad size is given 5.5 by 0.8 meters. We need good mechanical handling facility. A 3000 ton per hour capacity conveyor will be running parallel to the jetty. We need certain buildings like gate complex, administrative building, port operational buildings, canteen, fire station, maintenance workshop, comes electrical stores, substations. Then this is important, the transport linkages. We need the road link, rail link, power supply and water supply. There is one NX67 which is passing through Nagapattinam, which is about 21 kilometer away. There is a state highway which is passing through Velangadni, which is about 13 kilometer. The Nagapattinam railway station is 21 kilometer. There is another railway station at Thiruvarur which is 32 kilometer, and Thiruthirappondi which is 23 kilometers. Power requirement is 24 MVA for first phase and 48 MVA for second phase. The water demand is given so many liters per day, 3 lakhs liters per day, and potable water demand is 135 kiloliters. They are planning to have a desalination plant taking the sea water for this purpose. This is the cost estimate for phase 1 and phase 2 development. This is the incremental cost. So in the phase 1 we have the breakwater which is about 200 crores. Phase 2 we do not have any breakwater. In phase 1 we have 130 crores of berth. In phase 2 we have 65 crores of berth. Container yard will be developed here, 42.2 crores. Here it is 22.05. Dredging is 300 crores in the first phase and 400 crores in the second phase. This cost is very high, this dredging cost. Then we need shore protection measures, that is the training walls, electrification, here also electrification is required, water supply cost, mechanical works 160 crores, here also 160 crores. We have to put the navigational aids, ancillary infrastructure, design and supervision, this is about 964 crores and this is 672 crores. So with this we complete the DPR for Thirukkovali port. All along I was telling about breakwater and dredging and so many requirements. These are all required on the east coast, whereas if you see one facility on the west coast, this shows the Google map. So the natural protection is there, no breakwater, nothing is required, only some dredging is required and the berth will be built here. This is on the estuary of a river. So complete protection is given for this. This is the capital cargo berth for Dhopavay power station. The latitude and longitudes are given. The location is in Ratnagiri district, and we have to provide a turning circle, approach channel and dredging is required. The berthing size is 300 by 24 meter, vessel size is Panamax, the handling capacity is 5 million tons per annum. Future will increase the number of berths to 2, length from 300 to 600 meter, the capacity will be increased from 5 million tons per annum to 10 million tons per annum. Strictly speaking, any berth, any port facility what you are creating, minimum capacity to be developed will be of the order of 5 million tons per annum. Anything less than that will not be viable. 5 million tons per annum means approximately 500 crores you have to spend to develop the facility. Here there is no breakwater for this port, only dredging is required for the diameter training circle and the approach channel. So from 16 meter contour we create a approach channel, that is shown in this slide. This is a 16 meter long approach channel, I am sorry, 6.4 kilometer long approach channel. This is your 16 meter contour. So here we have the training circle and the berth is shown here. This is well shielded, there is a small bay here inside this, so no current will come and disturb the vessel, waves also will not come and disturb the vessel here. This is the power plant. So from the power plant you need an access for this port. There is a conveyor which will transport the coal from here to this location. So very simple configuration, and this can be built very easily also. The coal handling capacity is, we provide 2 ship unloaders, That means whenever we load and unload, we need two cranes. If you start loading or unloading from one side alone, the vessel will trim and it will get submerged. So we need two cranes. So this is ship unloaders, capacity is 2000 tons per hour. So if you are working about 20 hours, then it will become 40,000 tons per day. So with two unloaders, it becomes 80,000 tons per day. So one vessel can be cleared in 24 hours. So we have two streams of 2000 ton per hour of conveyor, which is running parallel to the full length of the berth. Then we need some stacker and reclaimer. This is whenever it goes to the plant, somewhere here we have to stack it and we have to reclaim it, then use it. For that purpose we need a stacker and reclaimer here. Then we need some buildings, like as discussed previously, all these buildings are to be provided. Similarly, we need the road link, it is connected to State Highway 78. Power supply requirement, water supply, these are the requirements that are required for the berthing facility. Then we will talk about this deep draft berth, southern dock and bulk terminals at Paradip port. The location is Paradip port, which is 210 nautical miles of Calcutta port and 260 from Vizag. It is in between the Vizag port and Calcutta port. The vessel size is 125,000 TWT. The draft requirement is 16.5, that means the depth requirement will be about 18 meters. Length of the vessel is 275 and beam is 41.5 meters. We are seeing the Paradip port here. This red color shows the state of Orissa, and these are the nearby airport, and here we have the Mahanadi river, which is draining into the sea. This is the district map. Shows the satellite imagery of the total facility. We have a south breakwater and a north breakwater. The existing facilities are the south breakwater for a length of 1200 meters, north breakwater for a length of 540 meters. We have an oil jetty here, 300 meter long. At present we have some facilities here. There is a east key, then there is a central key, there is a fertilizer berth, two fertilizer berth one, then we have a trawler berth here. This is called as the east key, this is called as the south key, and this is the east key 3, where we have some coal berth 1 and 2. This is the place where we handle the iron ore, and we have a dry dock here. These are the existing facilities. It is proposed to create two complexes. One is a southern dock complex, another is a BOT complex. In the BOT complex, it is planned to develop a coal terminal and a iron ore terminal, dirty cargo this side. So this side is a clean cargo area. Here it is proposed to develop a oil terminal here and a container terminal on this side. As you see here, this is a lagoon harbor, everything is land. They started dredging it and then creating this facility. Now this is a land area which they will be dredging and creating the new facilities. Whenever the vessel will come here, just like earlier I explained for mega terminal, it will stop here, then it will go for a distance of about 2 kilometers here. Then it will get stopped and we are going to create a turning circle here. Once the vessel turns here, it comes back and it will come inside this basin or oil terminal and then get berthed. This is the requirement. Because of the construction of this breakwater, you can see lot of deposition on this side and erosion on this side. So when we plan for dredging, we will use as a stockpile on the northern side. Each berth, coal berth and iron ore berth, length is 370 meter because the vessel size is longer. Width is 24 meter, top level is kept as 5 meter, dredge level is 17 meter. Annual throughput of coal will be 14 million tons and iron ore will be 10 million tons. The dredging for coal berth is 2 million cubic meter, iron ore berth is 2 million cubic meter. So this much has to be dredged. This is for the requirement of coal berth and iron ore berth. So, we have to provide two unloaders, the stackers, reclaimers, container conveyors, and then we also need a wagon loading system to load, to unload the coal which is coming from the hinterland. This for the ore terminal, the capacity is 10 million tons. Here the capacity of the unloader is 4000 tons per hour, because the density of iron ore is more than the coal. So, for the same volume the weight will be more, that is why we have a bigger capacity here. Then stackers should be there, reclaimers also should be there, the container also, the conveyor system also should be here. Then we need a dumper also for emptying the iron ore from the railway wagons. All these buildings that are required, the linkages, road, rail, power supply and water supply requirements are listed here. These are most common things that is required while preparing a detailed project report. We have to plan and design the infrastructure. When you plan it, you should see that you are not disturbing the existing dry dock, and minimum disturbance to the existing township area. We need some reserve berths for oil terminal, develop a dedicated rail link to the southern dock, and you have to align the dock system parallel to the existing dock. This is for the clean cargo facility which are being developed on the southern side. So, earlier we have seen the BOT complex where we are handling coal and iron ore. Now we are discussing at the southern dock complex, which is a clean cargo complex. The townships are very nearby. This side there is no township, this side there is a township. There is a dry dock which is already built. I was listing that these things should not be disturbed. That is what is listed in this infrastructure planning and designing for the clean cargo terminal. Now we will see the oil berth. This also is planned in two stages. First oil berth will be developed, then the container terminal will be developed. There will be one turning circle here. Oil berth typically consists of an approach jetty, a jetty head, berthing dolphins and mooring dolphins. This oil berth may handle a smaller vessel like this or a bigger vessel like this. Smaller vessel, these two dolphins are sufficient. For a bigger vessel we need extreme dolphins here, and the width required for the dock basin is about 300 meters. The for cargo handling system, we need marine unloading arms. This is for transfer of products from the shore to the tankers. Four arms with the two each exclusively for white oils and black oils will be provided. These are interchangeable. We need also electrical units. The dredging required is about 3.97 million cubic meter, this area as well as near the berth. The buildings what are required, then fire safety and pollution control is very important for this also. Main sources of pollution are discharge of oil by ships, discharge of bilge. Bilge means a water which they carry for keeping the draft same, whether it is loaded or unloaded condition. I am sorry, not bilge, this is the ballast that I was talking. Industrial effluents, dust from cargo, etc. There is a regulation called MARPOL regulation that also should be followed. The next is clean cargo terminal on the other side. You have the oil cargo this side, then the clean cargo container cargo is on the other side. Originally you develop this 300 meters, dredge and operate, then you develop another 300 meters and then operate. The berth requirement is 300 meter by 34.25 meters, dredge depth is 17.1. These are the terminal buildings that are required, the dredging that is required. These are the cargo handling system. One is called as a rail mounted key crane, which is used to lift the container and then keep it here. Then we have a rubber tire gantry crane, which will be used to move the containers in the stacking yard. Then empty handler, this is a forklift truck. Then we may have a crawler mounted crane, then reach stacker and tractor trailer. This is to transport the container. These are the various cargo handling systems. Thank you.